Good morning. Before we begin, I would like to acknowledge that we meet and we learn from each other today on country. I'm coming to you from the State Library of New South Wales, a quite young library that sits on one of the world's great ancient repositories, a rich collection of oral tradition. I am, of course, on Gadigal land, and I pay my respects to elders past, present and emerging, and I extend that respect to all Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islanders who are here with us today for another great scholar talk in our series. So my name is Rachel Franks, for those of you who don't know me, and I'm the coordinator of scholarship here at the library, which means I get to look after their fellows. And it's always exciting to hear about what they've been doing here at the library with our collections. And of course, last year was particularly problematic, but our fellows were still in and doing what they could and producing great results. And it's a treat today to have Claire Monagle with us delivering her scholar talk. Claire is an associate professor at Macquarie University. She specialised in medieval theology and is now looking more closely at feminism and theology. And that is some of what we'll be hearing from her research as the 2019 Australian Religious History Fellow here at the Library. If you have any questions for Claire from today's talk, please use the chat feature in Zoom, and we'll come to those after her presentation. Thanks so much, Claire.
Hello, everybody. It's lovely to be here in this still strange virtual form, but it is lovely to be here. Before I begin, I wanted to thank Rachel Franks for all that she does for the fellows at the library. Rachel is extraordinarily kind and generous, as well as, of course, highly efficient and impressive in all that she does. And I don't think I've felt as special in my career as when the fellows of 2019 got inducted at the library. And it was one of the very brief and rare experiences of a form of academic celebrity I've ever had. So I'd like to thank Rachel for making us feel so special and so well cared for in our time at the library. So I'm here today to talk about Magdalene Journal, which was published by a group of women, mostly out of Sydney, between 1973 and 1987. And there is a complete run of the collection of the journal at the State Library of New South Wales. There is also a run at the Jessie Street Library as well, and I think maybe in Canberra as well, but actually it's a relatively rare resource, the actual print copies, and it hasn't been digitised as far as I know. So it was and has been and continues to be an amazing treat and a pleasure to sit with these journals that, you know, you can't quite smell the gestetner print off the text, but they're fairly rudimentary in the way they were produced. They're very kind of organic publications, and so it's been an absolute pleasure to have the time and the resources. Thank you to the library to be able to look at the journal, and I also think that it is something, the journal should in fact be digitised at some point, because as I'm going to argue today, I actually think Magdalene Journal in its entirety offers a substantial resource for the history of feminism in Australia, particularly the second wave, and one that has not been used in the way that I think it should be for really understanding the scale, the scope, the ambition, the disappointments, and the excitements of second wave feminism in Australia. I'll just give you a tiny bit of background about the journal, but more will come as I proceed. In 1968, a group of women, Christian women in Sydney, got together and founded a group called Christian Women Concerned, who were a group of women who were informed by and excited by ideas of women's liberation that were emerging, particularly out of the United States. They talk in particularly about the impact of Betty Friedan on their thinking. And originally, Christian Women Concerned began as a fairly organic group of women meeting together to discuss the new kind of flourishing of feminist ideas and excitement that was in the air, and that was coming also subsequently from texts like Female Eunuch and Kate Millett's Sexual Politics. It originally began as a kind of group who met to discuss texts and talk, but they were defined also by their Christianity and their commitment, however wavering, to participation in church life of multi-denominations, and trying to work out how to reconcile, negotiate, work out the tensions they felt between their emerging sort of vibrant feminist consciousness and their sense of the oppressive structures of the churches, to which at this point in 1973, many of them still felt very, very committed. I should also say that most of the women involved in Christian Women Concerned had prior experience in social movements, particularly the peace movement. And so many of them had cut their teeth on forms of activism and protest already through participation in the movement against the Vietnam War, but more broadly also the peace movement in general. But I will explain more about them, about these women and this group, Christian Women Concerned, as I go on. They decided to found the journal in 1973, and it ran, as I said, until 1987, producing four issues a year. And the editorial work was shared. Each edition, four women would take responsibility for producing the journal. And the journals usually covered a theme. Some of them are kind of more conceptual or emotional. There's one issue is devoted to the sort of ideas of guilt and how it pertains to women in churches. There's another one about celebration, you know, so some of them are about sort of thematic ideas about women, embodiment and society. And then some of them are very, very targeted to social issues. There's an issue on abortion. There are issues about motherhood. And in particularly in the years 74, 75 and 76, there's a lot of discussion and many issues are devoted to International Women's Year and a number of the structural activities that are happening within churches to address or deal with the challenge posed by Christian feminism and the feminist movement more broadly. But I thought I would begin not with a text from the journal itself, but with a poem written by Mari Tulip, who was one of the stalwarts of Magdalene. And Mari Tulip would go on to have a career as an academic and a feminist theologian. I should also say about the women who founded Christian Women Concerned, when they founded the group and in the early years of Magdalene, most of them had young children. And so while they're not as young or as unencumbered as the women we normally think of as being the birthers of the second wave in Australia, the university students, the Kate Jenningses or the Anne Summers. These women are a little bit older and tended to be married and to be caring for quite young children in the initial years of Magdalene. And so many of the women involved with Magdalene went on to have significant careers in various strata of life after Magdalene or in the later years of Magdalene. And that also correlated to their children growing up and their change in their situations as well. Mari Tulip became a feminist theologian and an academic, and she's actually in this book, which is Barbara Kane's Companion to Australian Feminism, which came out in 1999. And Mari actually wrote the section on religion and spirituality for this group, for this book. But to give you a little bit of a sense of Mari, in the list of contributors for this very, very, this is a very serious book published by Oxford University Press. It's got all the academic bona fides, obviously. In the list of contributors where people write about their achievements and why they're authorised to write on this topic in such a, venerable place, where most people will cite their academic works or their professional positions, Mari Tulip just said in the list of contributors, Marie Tulip has been an activist and writer in feminism and religion since 1970 and is still hopeful. And I think that that statement gives you a sense of her sort of ludic, playful self. She published a book of poems in 1999, and I wanted to share the poem with you, even though it's subsequent to the period of Magdalene's publication, because to me, this poem animates the tension at the heart of Magdalene, the energy, the confusion, and the desire. And the tension is, of course, about reconciling faith in Christ, which these women, at least at the beginning of the journal, these is the thing that unites the women who are involved in the journal. Besides their feminist commitments, it is also a commitment to faith in Christ. The overwhelming tension and intellectual energy of Magdalene, as well as its passion, comes from the negotiation of working out, can we have both? Can we hold on to these promises, these desires, this appetite for women's liberation? Can that be made compatible with our experiences within churches and more broadly faith in Christ? So Marie Tulip's poem, it's quite short, I promise, as you can see it here. She says, Christ, we say, good Lord, we say, but you are not good or God to us. You were the spirit in our flesh, our body life, but now your name's become a sword to cut us down. Do I stand with you? Or with the sister crippled by you? So at the heart of that poem is this tension between the idea of faith in Christ as an embodied, sensual, fleshly experience that gives life, as many of the women involved with Magdalene saw it, and the name of God, Christ, good Lord. The authoritative, oppressive name of the Father that is used invariably to, as the women of Magdalene see it, to oppress women, to render their fleshy lives less important and less significant than those of men, and to deny them full participation and leadership in the churches to which they belong. Marie Tulip began in 1973 very optimistic, still hopeful, as she says, about the capacity of Magdalene Journal to carve out a space where faith in Christ could be disaggregated from the name of the Father, the authoritative structure, the patriarchal structures attached to a Christian God. She's more ambivalent by the end, and this poem is precisely about that tension and that the difficulty that for many women involved with Magdalene becomes or remains irreducible. So in the first edition of 1973, Marie Tulip wrote on the opening page. So this is sort of the first enunciation or articulation of Magdalene's message. She wrote, none of us has any authority except our own experience, our faith, hope, and love. We are simply people trying to be responsible in our own lives. Nor do we accept any authority over us rather than that of Christ. So on the one hand, we get this explication of the new forms of authority being claimed by women's liberation in particular. The personal is political. The need to unshackle ourselves from the structures around us that have told us what womanhood is, what a woman's role is, what are the meanings that should be attached to women's bodies. There's a real claim there for women's experience and women's life as being all the authority that one needs. Where it differs from other texts in women's liberation that are Western and secular is, of course, that there is one caveat on we are our own authority, which is that we do accept the authority of Christ. So Marie Tulip wrote that in 1973. However, in the final edition of the journal in 1987, Marie Tulip goes back to that moment and says, We also said on page one that we do not accept any authority over us other than that of Christ. She wrote, many of us would say that differently today, since both Christ and the concept over are embedded in the patriarchal traditions over which we are still working to disentangle ourselves from. In fact, our relation to a shared religious context is becoming ever more problematic. We could go on critiquing the language and forms of patriarchy, but finding a new language which includes the religious dimensions of our lives is turning out to be a very long-term venture. And so what Mari Chulip was articulating there in 1987 was that the project of Magdalene, if I can conceive it of that, which was to find the space to be to experience women's liberation combined with what they saw as Christian liberation, the full-bodied devotion to what they argued were the egalitarian radical spiritual messages of Christ. At the end of the talk, at the end of this, at the iterations of Magdalene 987, Mari Chulip doesn't say we didn't get there, but nor does she say we got there. She's saying it was much more harder and complicated than we anticipated, because we were hopeful that we could use the tools of language to reconcile these competing, what felt like competing strains in their lives and competing desires. But actually, they had come to realize as a collective that even the core terms with which they articulated themselves in 1973, even the name Christ, had become problematic and unable to be made safe and free and appropriately liberatory in a way that was consonant with their demands for women's liberation. But I should stress, though, that the 1987 final issue, though, is not a sad issue. It's actually a very celebratory issue, because while the women involved are very reflective about who they were in 1973 and who they had become in 1987, they're also really delighted and astonished by all that has been achieved and what has transpired. I also should mention too that when I quote the journal, it says Mari T down the bottom, because that's how people were named in the journal. Most contributors only had their first name attached to what they had written. And it's another move that is consonant with the kind of radical, the radical project of women's liberation, which was less about forms of authority and less about forms of pedigree, but more about ideas of authentic communication and sharing that were generous and not about defensive pedigreed grandstanding. Jean S. wrote this little comment in the final issue of 1987, and Jean S. happens to be Jean Skuse, who many of you may have heard of, who was extremely active in some of the more structural reforms initiated by Christian Women Concerned and Magdalene, and I'll talk a bit more about that in a minute. But she also offers a really great reflection on what's happened over the period of Magdalene's publication. She says, so why is it that 15 years later, the longed for new heaven and new earth have not emerged? And she says, looking back, I think we were naive. We thought we only had to write about or draw attention to our oppression, and all those good Christian people would see the light and correct injustices. I think that's a really lovely reflection on the sort of the fervor of the new convert, as they were, to women's liberation. These women did believe that they were surrounded by good people who would be shocked at how sexist the churches were and appalled, and would seek to remedy all of the errors and oppressions and prejudices inherent in Christian life. They did not find that, however. She says, I believe at first we saw women's liberation as a justice issue for us, with the promise of a new community for all. We wrote, as Mari did in a paper on liberation theology and sexism, that the women's movement is saying something truly prophetic and liberating, not only for women, but for men, children, and the earth too. The reality, however, has been somewhat different. What has happened over these years? Well, I'll give you a quick account of what happened over those years, at least in terms of the list of achievements. Christian Women's Concerned, as I said, was founded in 68, but by 1973, they had decided to become, and explicitly so, a consciousness-raising group using Magdalene for reflection and outreach. And they developed their consciousness-raising skills using the same materials as other groups active in women's liberation. And I really like this detail. The first issue was printed on the Communist Party's Gestetner machine. Once they started getting subscriptions, they were able to afford to pay for printing. But I think that the fact that they had access to the Communist Party's Gestetner machine tells us, as many of the things I've discovered tells us, is that these women were not siloed as Christian feminists, completely out of touch with the remainder of this, whatever else was going on the second wave. They forged strong connections with other women's groups, and they were very active in a number of the same movements, particularly around reproductive rights, and most particularly they were very, very active in the movement around women's shelters and even the process of naming domestic violence as a problem and as something that needed amelioration. Magdalene was sold in feminist bookshops throughout its run, and Magdalene publicised sister publications such as Refractory Girl and Vashti's Voices on its pages. So if there is kind of a canon of these second wave publications in Australia, Magdalene deserves to be placed alongside those publications and to be studied with the same rigour and attention as those publications have been given. And I think the fact that Magdalene has received very little scholarly attention indicates feminisms and feminist history's profound ambivalence and discomfort with history of religion, and particularly with the idea of a Christian feminism. As I've said, each issue was edited by four women, a task that was shared across the collective. In terms of sort of affecting structural change, Magdalene and Christian Women Concerned lobbied very, very hard, and in fact were instrumental in the establishment of the Commission of the Status of Women, which took place as part of the Australian Council of Churches, which really began its sort of machinations around 1974. And this part of the work was led, from what I can tell, extremely dexterously by Jean Scoos, who I mentioned already. She'd had experience in church governance and church reform in the United States. She was Australian, but she had been in the United States doing some of this type of work. And then she returned to Australia and really became extremely active in the work for the Commission of the Status of Women, you know, actively generating the reports and continually lobbying for the continuity of the Commission of the Status of Women with the Australian Council of Churches. In fact, she became Executive Secretary of the Australian Council of Churches during the 1970s and was one of the few women in that period to achieve kind of executive status in the council. The Commission of the Status of Women was extremely active also in lobbying for funds, and they received a $30,000 grant from the Whitlam government for International Women's Year's events. And subsequently, Murray Tulip has written that they were not sure they would get a hearing and be able to access funds as part of this grant. $1 million was earmarked for funding for International Women's Year's events. They weren't sure how that Christianity would sort of stack up in terms of the project of International Women's Year as it was being rolled out by the Whitlam government. So they were surprised and grateful and delighted when they received $30,000. The grant enabled conferences. They brought in overseas scholars to their conferences. Rosemary Reuter came to a conference that they held in Coogee. They developed a resource library. They had lectures, public lectures that were available for anybody to attend. They actually published books for a while using this money. $30,000 went a long way back then. And they were able to send members over to international Commission of Church events or similar events to that which were happening in Australia. And through those international relationships, the women of Christian Women Concerned were able to build a number of really significant relationships with Christian feminists in the Asia Pacific, as well as in India and South Africa. And racial politics is something that was taken up very keenly by Magdalene. Part of it, I think, was because church structures are already geared towards international communication through practices of, I mean, churches are international organisations, and practices of missionary networks meant that a number of relationships were already there. And Magdalene took very, very seriously the relationship between racial liberation to women's liberation. And while they were almost entirely white women, and their politics were not probably intersectional in the way that we would think of it now, I did not detect in my reading of Magdalene's articles on racial inequality, particularly in places like South Africa, as well as in discussions of Indigenous issues in Australia, I did not detect any whatsoever Christian paternalism. They encountered racial issues, I would argue, informed much more by left-wing politics and the left-wing politics a number of them had been trained in particularly in the peace movement. One of their biggest achievements was achieving quotas of gender balance in the governance of the new Uniting Church. They achieved those for 6 years, and it was to the great disappointment and anger of many of them that the clauses were sunset clauses and they were able to be abandoned after 6 years. But at least for the first 6 years of the Uniting Church's existence, there were significant quotas insisting on women's leadership in that new church. Dorothy McRae McMahon might be the most famous alumna of Magdalene. Particularly those of you, many of you in Sydney will recognise the name. And she wrote in 2007 that another sort of tension or issue that had come to light through Magdalene's years, and she wrote this many years afterwards, thinking about the end of Magdalene, was that, and it's interesting, none of them use words like the group was split. She doesn't describe it in terms of conflict, but she does say that there were competing or different ideas about ordination. And Dorothy McRae McMahon wrote, 2007, some of us saw the right to ordination as a priority, and others felt that the ordained ministry was too closely connected to male power. So somebody like Marie Tulip seems to abandon church life almost entirely, and it seems very clear that seeking ordination for her would be throwing, as far as she was concerned, would be throwing good money after bad, because her efforts to reform and think about reform in the church to her indicated that the patriarchy of churches was so embedded and so restrictive that reform was not possible, and that women had to seek spiritual liberation outside of church structures. But for Dorothy McRae McMahon, she, on the other hand, sought ordination and became an extremely influential and important Uniting Church minister, and in fact, in many ways, kind of a public spiritual figure. But before I tell you a little bit about her career, which I think again testifies to Magdalene's work in nurturing and educating and skilling up a number of women in order to be able to take public roles. Before I talk about Dorothy's work, her more public work, I just wanted to give you a hint of her in the journal over the years. That's a picture of her quite recently wearing her dog collar. But I wanted to mention this image from Sydney Morning Herald in 1977, which gives you a bit more of a sense of what Christian women concerned were about and what they were what their methods were. The Sydney Morning Herald article concerns the consecration of bishops in the Anglican Church at Sydney Cathedral in 1977. And Janet Scarfe, who was one of the leaders in the movement for the ordination of women, has noted that when they wanted to protest this consecration, I don't know if that's the right term. I'm sure I'm missing some proper ecclesiastical term, but they wanted to protest that these were all you know, all that these were all men being consecrated as bishops, and to cast light again on the dominance, the sort of the naturalized dominance of the male clergy in the Anglican Church. But Janet Scarfe notes it was quite hard to get the Anglican women to turn out. So whoever organized it made a few calls to Christian women concerned, and they turned out in order to do the protest work. So I think that I really like that anecdote too. It gives you a sense of their sort of, I don't know, their sort of their desire to be mobilized and their capacity to get into the fray. Anyway, we first hear from Dorothy, as she is in Magdalene, in 1973. And you get a sense of the project of Magdalene here when she says, "Let's not expect that each contribution will be a well-rounded picture of one woman's life with all her attitudes and activities listed and explained. We are not making comprehensive policy statements that give people the right to ask, what about the workers or what about the children? We are simply sharing a moment of truth, a new awareness of growth, a feeling that belongs to us, a fear or a hope. Some of us will share it with emotion, others with calm logic. Each is equally personal as long as it is true to us." And I should say that just because she said people don't have the right to ask what about the workers, this is not to say that Magdalene wasn't interested in the politics and the theology of labour. There's quite a bit devoted to that. Nor is it to say that they're not interested in children. There is a lot about maternity and about children and about children's capacities and flourishing in Magdalene. Her point is a bigger one. It is that the spirit of Magdalene and the spirit of this type of exchange is that of women's liberation. And again, that idea of the authenticity of experience and the necessity that women be free to actually say the truth, and that they do not need to be self-justifying. Liberation involves the freedom to be without the necessity of self-justification, as she writes. And what could be more basically Christian than that? And her point is that women's selfhood has always needed to account for its utility, its the role that it plays in society. It's rather than being essentially itself and women being accorded dignity and status by virtue of their personhood, women's identity, particularly in the church, but more broadly, has required forms of self-justification and proof of utility. And for Dorothy, liberation is being without having to do any of that, without apology, without self-justification. It is to experience being on its own terms. And this is very, very consonant with the language of women's liberation. Again, authenticity of being and the right to speak one's truth without needing to apologize, to be defensive, or to prove one's adequacy. And again, we see this yoking of that to a form and an idea of Christian liberation, that the real message of Christ is of radical being, radical personhood, as she saw it, and the freedom that one can enjoy and flourish within one's own radical personhood. In 1975, Dorothy wrote about, "In the days when I was a non-person, words barely penetrated the hard shell which protected me from real life experience." So she's accounting here her life before women's liberation, and in some ways before sort of a full-blooded Christian conversion as well. She narrates them as the same process. "It mattered not one whit to me if everything was said in male terms, because I was floating on the periphery of life, clinging to the security of minimum involvement. And suddenly it seemed the sounds and sensations of living flooded around me, a new birth experience, alarming, exciting, overwhelming in its challenge. I reached out everywhere for support and for ways of celebrating. And then I heard for the first time, bearing down upon my consciousness, Christ came to save all men. All men are called to be brothers. Peace on earth to me, to men of goodwill." God, I'm sorry about the typos, everybody. I did this on a tiny screen. "Sons of God, you are forgiven. At the very moment of my salvation and celebration, I was excluded." And so here we see, in the words of Dorothy, this articulation of the difference between the the liberation of both feminism and Christianity, the difference between how that feels and the structured patriarchal language with which the world, and in particular Christian revelation, is articulated. And this became something that Dorothy felt very, very strongly that she could not live with. And in later reflections, she says, it might seem strange that we were all so focused on language. People look back on that as kind of a funny, you know, triviality of the movement. But she said at the time, it just felt so urgent because the project at that time, as far as I can tell, the project was one of still thinking there could be this union between women's liberation and what they saw as Christian liberation. And so the desire to change the language, the desire for inclusive language, was about a sort of potent and a powerful notion that these things could be collapsed together into oneness, a project that, as a number of people we've heard from today, a project that was not, did not happen as fast or is perhaps not possible in the ways that they imagined. But the most startling thing that Dorothy writes in Magdalene, and I'm calling her Dorothy not out of disrespect, but because that's how she is in the journal, I found this most poignant, extraordinary piece of writing. The edition that was devoted to guilt in 1976, Dorothy published an account of having a severely disabled child. And she had three children, and her eldest child was the severely disabled child. And she talks about the guilt around the family's decision to put the child into care. She wrote, "The price became too high. The guilt at what we were doing to our younger children by keeping him at home with us became greater than our guilt at deciding to send him away. We wondered how people without that greater guilt made the harder decision with the pressures upon them, especially from within the church. God gave you this child. He will give you the strength to cope. Indeed, he gave you that child for a special purpose." And startlingly, and I find this incredibly powerful, startlingly she writes, "I want him to die because he is, I think, capable of a little love. He is sometimes happy, like when he is eating or curled up in bed, but the vast proportion of his life is made up of suffering, suffering that he cannot understand or transcend or deal with in any way. No one is going to make me feel guilty because now I want him to die simply to end his helpless human suffering." The reason I find this articulation extraordinarily powerful is that I think Dorothy is doing what she claimed to be about to do in 1973, which is attempting to live without self-justification, attempting to trust her own authority and her own moral compass in making obviously incredibly difficult decisions and dealing with life's profound, irreducible struggles. And what I also find extremely interesting is that she wrote this in 1976. So that was the year that her son went into care. And in that year, she began her training to become ordained as a uniting church minister. And so in this moment, in the way that Dorothy has articulated herself on the pages of Magdalene, we can see a number of things going on. We can see the stirrings of a politics and a theology, one that gives her, it seems to at least, gives her the strength to make hard decisions, ones that will be judged by other members of her church and by the broader community, but to make them in order to, because of her devotion to the dignity of all human lives and to her belief in that one needs not to justify oneself to other ideological systems. So she became a uniting church minister, and I'm not going to reprise too much of her career because I'm almost at the end, but Dorothy McRae McMahon was the minister at Pitt Street Church in Sydney until 1997, and she was probably one of the leading anti-apartheid activists in Australia in that role, hosting both Mandela and Desmond Tutu at Pitt Street. She was an amazing advocate too, also, particularly after 19, 1997 for the LGBTIQ community. She came out as a lesbian in 1997, very publicly, and in a way that really jeopardised her own comfort and security. She, as an anti-apartheid activist and organiser, she was targeted by neo-Nazis and received many threats of violence, as well as sort of stalking, and which I guess is a form of violence. You know, she really was a kind of strong figure of feminist authority, lesbian authority, LGBTIQ authority, and a powerful campaigner, particularly on issues of apartheid. And who knows if she would have got there without Magdalene? You know, we don't know. But it's I think that Magdalene, the journal, and thinking about the history of these women enables us to track the absolutely crucial role played by Christian feminism in the history of Australia's second wave, and one that has really not been considered, I don't think, at all in the scholarship of the second wave. And I think it's at a huge cost to us not to enjoy, understand, and think about the role played by these women in generating the excitement of the second wave, but also in advocating for transformational reform within the churches, as well as this group also showed great solidarity with other second wave movements, as I said, particularly domestic violence, but also they were very, very active in issues around reproductive politics. And their addition on abortion, while women in that issue expressed personal ambivalence about abortion, the overall tenor of that edition was that that there is no point even questioning or thinking about whether abortion is right or wrong when we live in a society that is so sexist and punishes women so severely for their reproductive function. So while they evince some personal concern about abortion, that concern is completely outranked by their conviction that the structural life of women means that they cannot make choices about reproduction in ways that give them dignity, and therefore abortion is necessary in the world that we live in. So I will finish up soon. My conclusion is, this is early days for me with this research. I'm keen to learn a lot more, and I'm really tremendously excited by what I have found out so far. I have found journeying with Magdalene really, really fascinating. And I just wanted to say at the end that I really hope that other scholars, other people who tell stories of the second wave, will find ways to bring Magdalene and Christian feminism into this account. I actually think that the history of feminism does itself an injustice by ignoring things like Magdalene, because it actually makes the movement seem more limited, more university-based, more young women-based than it actually was. And it means also that significant achievements such as church reform are not counted amongst the achievements of the second wave when I think they should be. I just wanted to finish off with this picture on the left here, on my left, which is sort of tells us about what things we miss when we don't think about religion's role in feminism. And as many of you will know, the woman in the middle there is Betty Friedan, founder of the National Organization of Women, and of course the author of the Feminine Mystique. But I wanted to mention the nun. So the nun's name is Sister Joel Reed, and she was one of the founders of the National Organization of Women, and took a very active role in the early years. And she doesn't really figure in many of the histories of now, and nor does the woman to her left, whose name is Anna Arnold Hodgson, who was a leading civil rights activist, very involved in the Methodist Church, who had mobilised 30,000 white Methodist church leaders to attend 1963 Civil Rights March in Washington. She was also a founder of National Organization of Women, and she was her whole sort of career combined activism for both civil rights and feminism from her position within the Methodist Church. Sister Joel Reed, the nun, the reason I wanted to finish with her to sort of just to remind us that we don't always know the full story. The picture was taken in 1969, just after Vatican II. Sister Joel Reed preferred not to wear a habit, or if she wore a habit, she would wear a pretty minimal one. However, Betty Friedan would always ask her to wear the full habit for whenever the meeting with Congress people in order to add legitimacy and rigor to National Organization of Women. You know, even the nun in the habit is on our side, was the argument that Betty Friedan wanted to make. So Sister Joel Reed, Sister Joel Reed was there at the start. Her feminism was Catholic, it was Christian. She was embracing the reforms of Vatican II. And her history has only recently begun to be written as part of the National Organization of Women. So my overall point is I want to encourage everybody to dwell in Magdalene if they can and if they're interested. And also I really encourage everybody to think about why we assume so easily that second wave feminism was a secular movement, why we assume that abortion doesn't go with Christian consciousness or, you know, support for abortion, why we assume that Christianity and the right are natural bedfellows. I think that we make those assumptions on the basis of very, very recent history. And I think it is exciting to go back and realize that it hasn't always been thus. Thank you very much.
Thanks so much, Claire. Such a fascinating history and all those powerful, strong women. I'm especially taken by the idea of presenting a truth but not having to offer it with a companion proof of utility piece. We do have quite a few questions coming through. The first one is wanting just to pick up a little bit on your conclusion, and perhaps if you could say a couple of words about why we are so uncomfortable in engaging with these fascinating Christian histories here in Australia.
I think there's a couple of reasons. I think that if you're wanting to tell an exciting story about the second wave, and most recently I just saw Brazen Hussies, which is a fantastic documentary about the history of the second wave. If you're wanting to tell an exciting story, I think that a group of women at university having exciting secular times offers a much more sort of, you know, televisual story than do women with kids around them in church halls. I think that that's part of it. I think in terms of sheer narrative power, a secular second wave is an easier story to tell. I also think that we in Australian history departments across Australia, we don't teach history of religion very well. So I think that actually there's real inadequacy in our training of graduate students to enable them to be comfortable with thinking about the history of religion. So I think there's structural failure there as well. And I actually think that secular feminists are very, very uncomfortable themselves with religion. I think they do see it as irreducible for the most part, and the churches as so completely patriarchal and so completely male dominated that there's a sort of natural assumption that is made that women who seek accommodation with those institutions must in some ways be suspect in terms of their overall loyalties.
A great question that's come through. So Magdalene Journal, these women are part of the second wave of feminism. So the question is, did those women working on the journal, did they reflect at any point on first wave Christian feminists, and particularly how Christian temperance women supported the suffragette movement?
Well, I think that the women of Magdalene practiced their own kind of historical denial, because while they're very celebratory about some forms of first wave Christian feminism, I think they're a bit uncomfortable with what they see as the wowserism of the temperance movement. So, you know, everybody's got an identity issue to worry about. So they actually are somewhat ambivalent about aspects of first wave feminism, because I think they see that as being, some of it being a little bit too much do-gooderism that reflects forms of Christian paternalism that they are trying to avoid. But certainly, I mean, it's interesting, in the history, in historiography of the first wave, nobody has any problem in dealing with the Christianity of the first wave, I think because it's more distant. But the problems, the historiographical problems, really emerge in relation to the second wave.
We have another question. It's possibly a little bit out of scope, but somebody is writing in saying they're curious about the degree to which Australian Catholic nuns participated in Magdalene. So you mentioned Sister Joel Reid. Some people were deeply engaged with feminism and theology in the post-Vatican II period. Are there any comments you can make about that?
There were some Catholic women involved with Magdalene, but they were lay women, and they were part of that. They tend to be part of that cohort of, you know, young children married at the time of the founding. There's very little. Doesn't seem to be much sort of structural relationship with nuns, although there are moments where they will say, we recognise the important advocacy that this order is doing in Papua New Guinea on these issues. So they're very aware of it, but they're not working particularly closely with women who are in religious orders. They do occasionally, they sort of interview people. So they will do it. They occasionally interview a young novice. They did that once or twice and talked to them about their experience of it and their feminism. But it seems that the focus of Magdalene's effort was Protestant churches, and partly was because most of them came from Protestant churches, but also because if one of the dynamic and important issues was ordination of women, there was no sense that any traction was going to be got on that with the Catholic Church, whereas Protestant church structures and Reformed church structures were much more, because of the different idea of the priesthood, were much more malleable and open to the possibility of women's ordination. So I think that there's not a great deal of kind of strategic work between nuns and members of Magdalene. There's a lot of respect for a shared enterprise.
And speaking of that, so that taps into our next question. So you mentioned that the women were reading Bredy Freedon. Are you able to comment further on any of their other theological interests? For example, were they reading liberation theology from South America? And how much was their concern for a new kind of language? You mentioned language in the beginning of your talk.
They were obsessed with language in a way that, when they reflected on it, they admit it seems a bit ridiculous now that we were so obsessed with it. They read a lot of Rosemary Reuter. They read some liberation theology from South America, but probably their core canonical text was Mary Daly. And so for those of you who don't know, Mary Daly was an American feminist who was a Catholic and started off sort of thinking about, her first book was called The Church and the Second Sex. And her idea was, at the start, you know, we can reform, and then by the end of her career, she was, I hesitate to say this, but she was off the charts, and went really, completely rejected the church, into interplanetary goddess worship and all sorts of stuff. So Mary Daly, though, Beyond God the Father, that book is all about patriarchal language in the church, and that was their Bible. So, but they also read everything else. You know, they read everything that non-churchy feminists were reading at exactly the same time.
We have two super quick questions which we'll try and squash in. One is for the library. Will this session presentation be available to watch later? And yes, it is. We're making sure that all of our scholar talks will be available to people online. And so do watch out for the library's website. And if you subscribe to be alerted to scholar talks, you can write to scholarship@sl.nsw.gov.au and get on that terrific mailing list, and we'll let people know when new videos are available. And the last quick question is for Claire. Are you still hopeful as well?
Well, what made me hopeful reading Magdalene was that I feel so dismayed about the sort of divisiveness that attaches to in progressive political movements between the religious and the not religious, between, you know, the pure and the impure, with sort of, you know, ideas of who is properly political, who is impurely political. And I did feel hopeful in the sense of there are all these capacities for alliances and coming together in social movements that we have kind of forgotten. And it wasn't that long ago. It was, you know, 40, 50 years ago that these kinds of allegiances, these broad church coalitions were happening to produce really sort of dynamic forms of social change. And in current sort of ossified politics of left and right, I feel like we have really lost our memory that we can have commitments that we share with people, even if they might get that commitment because they believe in Jesus, and I have that commitment for a completely different set of ethical reasons. If we share the commitment, can that be enough to bring people together? So that makes me feel hopeful. And I know that we have to finish up, but I just wanted to very naughtily say hello to my mum and my mother-in-law who are on lockdown in Melbourne.
Yes, we've had a few people from Melbourne join us today. We're glad that we can bring you still talks to you at home or wherever you might be. So thank you all very much for coming. Thanks so much, Claire, for being one of our favourite celebrity academics here at the library. Don't forget to join us next time. So on the 6th of July, we'll have a little bit of a delayed scholar talk. So Elizabeth Humphreys was caught up. She was about to deliver right when we went into a little bit of a COVID slump, and between being able to offer things on site and being able to do this online delivery that we're doing now. So Elizabeth Humphreys will be here, and she'll be talking about her work as the inaugural Hertzberg Fellow. So she investigated the lives of metal workers, and her topic is called Pressed and Strained. And she looks at their work lives, their family lives, and union commitment. So I do hope to see you all in July. Stay safe, everyone, and thank you for coming. Bye-bye.